Welcome to the Rappahannock County Board of Supervisors Candidate Forum. Tonight's event is sponsored by Rappahannock News and by Businesses of Rappahannock. I'm Teresa Wood, the President of Businesses of Rappahannock, and I'll be your host for this evening. We're going to start out by introducing the candidates. Please hold your applause until everyone has been introduced. Candidates, come on down. David Connick, write-in candidate, Stonewall Hawthorne District. Chris Parrish, incumbent, Stonewall Hawthorne District. Christine Smith, candidate, Piedmont District. Mike Biniak, incumbent, Piedmont District. Welcome. I would like to take a moment to acknowledge our sponsors this evening. First off, Rappahannock News, Dennis Brack, John McCaslin. Without them, this event would not be possible. Thank you very much. I'd also like to thank the Businesses of Rappahannock Board of Directors. We are an all-volunteer organization, and without these folks, this wouldn't have happened either. So first off, Jan Makla, who's not with us this evening, she had a little trip and fall and spent the afternoon in the ER. So she is our vice president. Melissa Schooler is the treasurer. Bernie Olson, secretary. Sheila Whaley is our Flint Hill representative. Toby Wheelock is the Washington representative. And Robert Archer is our Sperryville representative. Please give them a round of applause. Some of you may know me. I usually just go unscripted, but tonight is a little bit more serious. And so I'm going to be using my notes, so bear with me as I read through these. We have some very important details related to this forum that I'd like to share with you all. I'll make this as quick as possible. In case you don't know, Businesses of Rappahannock, I'm sure you know the newspaper, but we are a member organization of about 150 businesses and still growing. Our mission, one of the components of our mission, is to advocate for businesses. And by that I mean we want to let our businesses know what's happening in our county politics as well as state politics. So we are very pleased to host this event tonight. Thank you all for coming out. So tonight, in partnership with Rappahannock News, we bring you this Board of Supervisors Candidate Forum. It's important to know that this is not a debate, but rather an exploration of some of the issues that affect Rappahannock County. Each candidate will be given 3 minutes for an opening statement. The moderator will read a question or statement that has been selected by the moderator and the host. We have done our best to cover the important issues in this county. We will have missed a few, no doubt. The candidates will all answer the same question, directing their answers to you, the residents of this county, and the voters. We do not want the candidates to address each other. Again, this is a forum, not a debate. The candidates have not seen the questions prior to this evening, so their answers will be from the heart and the head, I hope. Each candidate will have 3 minutes to answer their question. We will strictly enforce the time limits. We are on a very tight schedule tonight, and we would like to get to some audience questions. I know that a lot of you have questions and submitted them, and thank you. It just depends upon our time schedule tonight, but we will do our best to answer those questions. Additionally, please be respectful of the moderator, your friends, and the candidates. This is not the place for booing, heckling, or cheering. You will have an opportunity to cast your vote on November the 7th. That will be the place to let your voice be heard. Tonight, you will learn many things about your candidates, including their position on important issues. You will also see how they respond to each other, to stress, and there was light. All of these factors are a component of these candidates, and they are all important. Please listen carefully and watch closely. Now, it is my honor to introduce our moderator, Marianne Clyde. Marianne is an expert in mental health in the workplace, speaking to businesses and associations about empowerment, team building, and relationship networking. She's a licensed marriage counselor and therapist in practice for over 27 years. She is an energizing speaker, and dauntless world traveler. She lived in Japan for 8 years and has visited more than 20 underprivileged countries. In her travels, she teaches about recovery from trauma, personal empowerment, and interpersonal relationships. She sounds perfect for tonight, doesn't she? She has written and published numerous articles, appeared on radio and television worldwide, commenting on topics ranging from gun violence to having a happy marriage. Host and producer of her own TV shows, she has also hosted a call-in radio show and has produced a CD on meditation. After launching 2 best-selling books, she now has released her most powerful book yet, called Zentivity, How to Eliminate Chaos, Stress, and Discontent in Your Workplace. Her latest book is yet another Amazon bestseller. Marianne is the founder of the Marianne Clyde Center for Holistic Psychotherapy in Warrenton, Virginia. She is the winner of the 2017 Best of Warrenton Award and also the founder of Be the Change Foundation, helping underprivileged women create and sustain home-based businesses. She recently acted as a facilitator in the discussions that brought about the unification of the Fauquier Chamber of Commerce and the Greater Warrenton Chamber. Over 2 days, she helped guide the talks between the organizations in a completely unbiased fashion, and they came together to be one once again. Please help me welcome Marianne Clyde.
Thank you, Teresa. And thank you. What a good-looking audience. Thank you for being here. We're so excited to have all our candidates here tonight. And so we'd like to welcome you and thank you for coming as well. And now we're getting ready for our 3-minute introduction statements. You ready for your opening statements? I'd like to first introduce Mike Biniak, incumbent supervisor of the Piedmont District.
Thank you. I want to thank you all for coming out here tonight. You are the ones who are creating the future of this county. 24 years ago, my wife and I bought a farm on Route 231. Not wanting to commute back to Northern Virginia, we started a day camp, began farming, started a B&B and a school. Bellmead Business supported this county with the property tax it paid, the sales tax it paid, the meals and lodging tax we paid. We also supported this county by hiring county residents to work in our B&B, to teach in our school, and to help in our day camp. Our farm helper is a young man who attended Rappahannock County School. I don't like to pay any higher property tax than necessary, and I am proud to say that in the last 4 years, while I was on the board, we have had not raised property tax, and in the last 2 years have not raised overall taxes in the county. We as a board, have worked hard to keep our taxes low. My life is this county. What is good for this county is good for me. I have a vested interest in following the comp plan and maintaining our open space and keeping our farm viable and protecting the natural beauty, the night skies. We have put our farm in conservation easement to protect some of what makes this place so special. Our wonderful community is another asset that makes this great place to live. The people who live and work here, volunteer here, who run the restaurants, wineries, gas stations, farms, churches, that make us so dynamic. My goal while on the board is to make sure our policies help promote appropriate businesses and community life. Our public school is the center of many families for community activities, school sports, school plays, after school activities, where our children learn and develop. I have worked to fund our school adequately without burdening the taxpayer. Broadband and cell service are key to continuing growth and jobs in the public safety. I support its development in this county. As supervisor, I've been on the Public Safety Committee for 8 years, on the Fire Levy Board for 4 years. I've served on the Fire Service Committee, where we've created a working agreement with the fire stations. When we faced the decision to keep a building official in county or outsource this job, I felt strong that we needed to keep it in-house, and now we have Rich. I spearheaded the lowering of the tax relief threshold for the elderly when it became too high because our index was tied to the Northern Virginia. I'm working on the Western Emergency Tower location.
Mr. Vidiak, thank you very much. We'll give you more time at your time. I appreciate that. Thank you. Very responsive. I love that. Next is Christine Smith, candidate, Piedmont District Supervisor.
Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. Thank you to the businesses of Rappahannock for hosting this event in conjunction with the Rappahannock News. And thank you to Teresa for organizing this evening and to Mary Ann for moderating for us. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Christine Smith. My husband's name is Ryan Allred, and we have two sons, Fletcher, a 2016 graduate of Rappahannock County Schools, and my younger son, James, who's in the elementary school. We live in Sperryville, next door to the fire hall, and also next door to my mother, Peggy Eubank, and my sister, Becky Smith, and also right next door to the barber shop that my stepfather ran for many, many years in Sperryville. This spring, when I thought about the election cycle coming up in our local offices and the possibility of uncontested elections, I was afraid we were going to miss a wonderful opportunity to discuss the challenges facing our county now and also where our county is headed in the future. I'm very concerned that we don't have an updated comprehensive plan and that we don't adequately address our zoning concerns in the zoning ordinances that exist now. I decided to run to take on the opportunity to run for office because when I thought about what an opportunity that would be, I realized I couldn't ask anyone to do it if I wasn't willing to do it myself. I am certain I can bring my life experiences in management, administration, work on different boards, including nonprofit and religious organizations, and my work with people in general. I love working with people, talking to people all the time, and I feel I can use all of those skills to better represent Piedmont District in Rappahannock County. I look forward to November 7th, and I'm uniquely qualified to be a steady, informed force for Piedmont District, plus bring my perspective as a young family and a member of the upcoming generation and a woman to address the challenges that face us now and look forward to planning our future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christine. Next, we have incumbent supervisor Chris Parrish from the Stonewall Hawthorne District.
Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out. So I've lived here all my life, which is 69 years, and I was raised on a farm, pretty isolated, no television, no TV. Went to the Forest Grove School for the first few years, which was probably one of the last schools around that did not have indoor plumbing. It was a two-room school with six grades, two teachers. And so anyway, I have been involved with county business throughout the years. I served on the Rappahannock County Electoral Board for 27 years. I represented the Republican Party in that respect. I've worked on five different reassessments right up until when I ran for supervisor. I was also president of the Rappahannock County Farm Bureau for 18 years. And under my leadership, we got the, along with Mitzi Young and Sunnyside Farm, we got the farm-to-table program established in the schools. And that's still an ongoing project. And actually, it's in the state of Virginia, helps out with that too now. So once my kids were raised, my son graduated from Rappahannock High School. And once they were raised, I decided to run for supervisor. That was 8 years ago. So this is my third time up. You know, I've only had one opponent in all these years, and I have to say he was a perfect gentleman. Hi, Terry. Currently, I have an opponent that I don't know. My mind's boggled with all these facts that I can't wrap my head around. For example, the idea that I would be involved in spending $5 million for a bike path. I mean, I wouldn't spend $5,000 for a bike path. And this just seems a lot of the figures are all twisted. Something like $600,000 added over the budget. I mean, it's something like $60,000 is the only thing that's, everything else is passed through. You know, grants, state money coming in that goes back out, it's all passed through money. It's not, I am really proud of how I have protected the taxpayer in this county. For example, we've got the same tax rate for the last 4 years. I pledge to keep the county the same. Look around you. Is it any different than 8 years ago? It doesn't seem to me that it is. And I am pretty, my time's up.
Very good. Thank you, Chris. Appreciate that. Next is Mr. David Connick. He is a candidate for the Stonewall Hawthorne District.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank BizRap and Teresa for putting this together, and also Ms. Clyde for acting as moderator. Ladies and gentlemen, Thomas Jefferson once said, "I prefer the tumult of liberty to the quiet of servitude." I hold that a little rebellion now and then is a good thing, and as necessary in the political world as storms in the physical. And he said that just about exactly 230 years ago, and it's still true today. I agree with my friend and incumbent in this race, Chris Parrish, who I've known for 40 of the 42 years that I've lived here, when he said in the newspaper last week that a little competition is a good thing. And it's just been a great experience and a wonderful opportunity for me to go around our district and meet people and just listen to what they have to say. The people of Stonewall District are a little agitated from what I've been seeing and hearing. They may not come to all the meetings of the Board of Supervisors and other bodies, and they may not read every article in the Rappahannock News, but if you go around and talk to them, they seem to have a sense that something is just not right with our county government. When I first came here and opened my law office, George H. Davis was a Commonwealth attorney. He first became Commonwealth attorney in 1936, and he served three different terms in that office, the longest stretch from 1960 to 1979. George had a great saying that I took to heart. If the washing machine didn't have an agitator, the clothes would never get clean. So I'm looking forward to tonight's forum and addressing the issues that are facing Rappahannock County. And I especially appreciate the opportunity to share my views not only with you all, but also with my fellow candidates. Because as far as I'm concerned, this race isn't about me and whether I win or lose. It's about what's in the best interest of Rappahannock County. And regardless of what happens next Tuesday, I hope that something that I say here tonight will be remembered and used for the benefit of everybody who cares about the future of our county. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Connor. You guys did great on the 3-minute thing. I really appreciate that. So keep your eye on the timer. And I'm going to now start the questioning with, you have 3 minutes to answer the question. I'll read the question once before the first person says it, but if you need it read again before you speak, just let me know and I'll be happy to read it again. So, Mike, would you like to be the first?
I'll be the first.
Okay, please go up to the podium. And here's your question. Question number one concerns broadband, and in particular cell phone service, or lack of it, in Rappahannock County. Do you think we need more cell towers and better broadband coverage?
Well, I think we need better broadband coverage. Cell towers, they might be important today, but the technology is moving so fast, they may not be what is carrying our cell phones and our broadband information. So I certainly don't suggest that the county build those towers, except for the one that we're considering for emergency services. But it is important. It's important for public safety. It's important for our young children. Although I don't necessarily approve the amount of time our teenagers spend on the cell phone as part of their life, as part of almost all business life today. They all have a cell phone, iPad, computer, you text. It's no longer the secretary taking a message. It's you connecting directly with the people that you are either doing business with or, so it is important. And I think the public safety side of it is probably the most important part, at least in my eyes, to be able to respond to emergencies, especially as our landlines seem to be deteriorating. And it also, I think, is very important for businesses. I think that potentially the future for many businesses here in the county are home businesses. And without that high-speed connection, either cell phone or especially broadband, to get your business out there in the world and work from home just won't happen. So I know people that do work from home here in the county because they do either have cable or DSL or one of the higher speeds. So I think that's very important. So I am for the building out of the infrastructure for cell phones and broadband. Thank you.
Thank you, appreciate that. Ms. Smith?
I just wanted to put a little plug in for the broadband survey, folks. I think the broadband survey deadline is the end of the day tomorrow. So I think when we see the results of that survey, we will better know what the needs of the community are in terms of broadband access. In speaking to a lot of people as I've been going door to door the last few months, I do hear a lot of concern about the lack of connectivity for internet services, how expensive they are, how limited they are, and how we are missing opportunities because we don't have that in the county. I'm certainly not advocating the county take on providing that, but we need to be open to a private-public partnership working through the broadband committee to help get this challenge figured out. In my professional career, many moons ago, I worked as a billing analyst for WorldCom, and I reviewed more contracts than I would care to remember for business class internet service. And I would love to be part of that discussion as it goes forward and see what we can do to help deliver this service to people that need it in the county without impacting our tax base. As far as cell phones go, there is a tower going up in Boston now, close to the Rappahannock County line. So I'm very curious to see how that might impact cell phone service in the county, what improvements that may make for certain areas. But I know from experience that there are many people who will lose landline service and not have it for weeks. And they will not be able to have cell phone service because of where they live. And it is very dangerous and it is very disheartening. I have a friend now that lives in Scrabble. Her landline is not reliable. She is out of work through no fault of her own and she can't get callbacks for jobs because her telephone isn't working and her cell phone isn't reliable. So when you're wondering how it impacts working families in Rappahannock, it impacts them every day. So I would think once the Scrabble Tower is up, or if we can have some projections about what that will afford the county, we could look at what areas still might need service and be open to opportunities to provide for those areas in the future. I hope that answers the question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Parrish, what are your thoughts?
So broadband and cell service is important for all the obvious reasons. There is a lot of technology right around the corner that's going to help us out a lot. I understand that Google has got some balloon that hovers and emanates a signal, and also in Manassas, there's a company that's creating an ultralight kind of carbon fiber airplane that's got solar panels on top of it, and it hovers for 32 months above the clouds, and it puts the signals right down in the Hollis, you know. So it's right around the corner. I know of counties that have spent money to put up towers thinking that they were going to rent out space on the towers, and it didn't happen, you know, and they spent millions of dollars for nothing. And so I also don't agree that the county should invest a lot of money into the broadband, because it's essential, more and more essential, not just for education and fire and rescue. It's essential to do anything, you know, to get insurance, to you know, sign up for Social Security, you know, all that stuff. So it's coming, and if we were a flat county, no problem, we'd have it, you know, but we're not, and so we have to deal with our geography. And that's about all I got to say about that. Also, we did vote in the permission for AT&T to put up towers, and it looked like they were going to build them like right away. And then they decided there weren't enough subscribers out here to justify the investment, and so they never built those cell towers.
Thank you. Mr. Connick.
Thank you. You know, folks, sitting here listening to the incumbents discuss these two really pressing issues kind of in part answers the question of why I'm running for this office. Because all I heard was a lot of generalities of people who have been on the board for 8 years, and that's all it is, generalities. Yeah, we need broadband, and yeah, we need cell service, and you know, maybe there's some new technology around the corner that's magically going to make Rappahannock flat and make it all possible. But so far, that hasn't happened, and it's not going to happen, at least not making the county flat. So I think the County Board of Supervisors has to show some leadership and to be a little more proactive in finding real solutions, not just talk about all these issues. Now, as far as the cell towers go, that's right. They negotiated some leases with companies, but they didn't put provisions in that required the companies to actually build the towers. And surprise, they didn't build them because of exactly what was said. There's not enough of a market here to make it economically viable. And there's not a whole lot that the Board of Supervisors can do about that. But when companies come and discuss these issues with the board, they have to put some teeth in the contract. And that's a place where I could be, I think, very helpful because I have a great deal of experience in public utility regulation. So I know about how to do that. And if I don't know, I know who to ask that will give me some creative ideas and innovative ideas that we can solve these problems. As far as the broadband goes, that's another issue that, again, is constrained because it's just not economically viable and because of the geography of the county or the topography. And so we have to work with what we've got. But for example, Augusta County just recently got a grant in the, from the state in the neighborhood of $300,000 to build and facilitate broadband in their county. And I think we have to learn from those other counties and follow their lead. So the broadband committee is studying this. I'm sure they're aware of that. And if I'm on the board, I will be guided by what they say and what they recommend. And we'll have to work within those constraints. One other thing that I want to say is this is another place where the Board of Supervisors had absolutely and utterly failed to serve the citizens of this county because of this, of what was discussed, the landlines. Each Verizon or whoever it is has a public service obligation to serve every customer, and they haven't written a single letter, they haven't complained, they haven't gone to the state representatives and the legislature to get some action to force Verizon to provide public service that they're obligated to do by their public service certificate. And if I was on the board, I would see that that was done. And also,
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
Okay, the second question is going to go to Ms. Smith first. Okay, so a second question surrounds the unique character of Rappahannock County. Even as urban sprawl creeps closer day by day, where do you stand on preserving our valuable natural assets, such as night skies, family farms, and open spaces in Rappahannock County?
You just said all the magic words. I don't know what else to say. I originally moved here with my family when I was a teenager in the 1980s, and I was just charmed immediately by the rural character and the agricultural nature of Rappahannock County. It is just a paradise, and of all the places that I could choose to live, this is where I choose to live. It means making a few sacrifices, you know, having a young family. But for me, those things that I get in return are so much more than anything I have to give up to live here. Night skies is obviously a home run, and the photos that it captures are just amazing. When they take the pictures of the Milky Way and people come to visit us, and I say this is one of the few places you can see the Milky Way, and it's just amazing. The open spaces, our farmers are wonderful, and I have a strong commitment to agriculture. Before we moved back to Virginia, I worked with farmers markets and agriculture in Georgia, and I really have a lot of compassion for the farming families that allow us to enjoy their scenic properties whenever we drive down the road or walk the roads in the county. What was the third thing?
It was really saying, even as urban sprawl creeps closer day by day, where do you stand on preserving the valuable natural resources?
Oh, urban sprawl. There was a very nice quote in the Farm Bureau booklet that they give you when you move to Rappahannock County that basically says, be careful of what you create when you move here, or you will find that you have moved somewhere you are creating what you have moved away from. And I think about people in the Southwest. When I was young, I had allergies, and people said, move out to Arizona, it'll be great for your allergies. Well, everybody moved to Arizona that had allergies, And everybody planted all the plants that they missed back home. And pretty soon, you have allergies in Arizona. So let's not have allergies in Rappahannock County. Let's keep it rural. Enjoy it for the character that it has. Not be open to that crawl from the cities. We're so protected by the mountains on one side, and our zoning ordinances are a huge help in keeping us our rural character. And you know, I love it here, and look forward to keeping it this way for my children in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you. Chris.
Start with the dark skies. I always carry this map of the dark skies with me. Rappahannock County is just about the only county in the entire East Coast that's still dark. It's a really precious thing that we have here. And I brought it up for public comment or public discussion a couple years ago, and the issue about property rights came up, which, you know, with obviously with the Farm Bureau, we're big into property rights. But my interpretation of that is, if somebody is trespassing their light onto me, that's trespass, you know, and so I have the right to stay dark if I want to. So I do believe if we could incorporate in new construction, requirement to have downward facing lighting in order to get an occupancy permit to move in, I think that would be fair. And there's, we are working with the, well, I say we, RLEP, Rappahannock League of Environmental Protection, is working with, and they've done a fantastic job working with the Rappahannock Electric Company, and they are now automatically on these outside lights putting in the downward facing lights, and they're also starting to reduce the lumen. And so if we can preserve these dark skies, then we can preserve our uniqueness on the East Coast. And also I'm also on the board for the Skyline Drive and the Park Service, and they also have a big dark skies initiation going on. And so it's important. As far as sprawl and development, I'm committed to keep development out of the county. I've put all my land into scenic easement, so it's protected from development in perpetuity. Can't go down any more than 100 acre lots. And so I've, you know, put my money where my mouth is, or whatever, how you want to say it. I believe in it, and I'm willing to sacrifice the value of my property in order to protect this county. Obviously, I love this county, and I'm committed to keeping it like it is. Was that the whole question?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. David.
That's my question. Could you repeat the question?
I will be happy to repeat the question. The second question surrounds the unique character of Rappahannock County, even as urban sprawl creeps closer day by day. Where do you stand on preserving our valuable natural assets, such as night skies, family farms, and open spaces in Rappahannock County?
Okay, thanks. Mm-hmm. Again, ladies and gentlemen, you know, we've heard a lot of what I like to call sunshine and lollipop talk about how great it would be if we did that, and how great it would be if we had dark skies, and we ought to do this and we ought to do that, but I didn't hear any concrete steps that we could take. The first thing that we need to do, and the key thing, and you can show that map, I want to remind everybody that when they had the night skies hearing about having a night skies ordinance, and then tabled it about 2 years ago, and then did nothing since that time about it, our then county attorney, Peter Luke, who's out there in the audience somewhere, made the comment when they put that map up on the screen that all the places that had a dark skies ordinance were the places that were the brightest on the map, and the place that didn't have any dark skies ordinance was Rappahannock County, and it was the darkest. So it's a question not of having a dark skies ordinance, it's a question of controlling and limiting growth, because when people come, they put up houses, and when they put up houses, they put up lights. And if you look at a map of the planet, the people that don't have houses are the places where there's no lights, and or no houses is where there's no lights. So the key to it is, first, the comprehensive plan. It's supposed to be revised and amended every 5 years. It hasn't been done since 2004. And the incumbents are up here. They have done nothing to promote it being done. They haven't sponsored or put out any money, appropriated any money for the studies that are necessary to update the comprehensive plan to see if the comprehensive plan is working or not. And those things should be, and there's not a mention, I don't think, of dark skies in the comprehensive plan right now. And so if it's an important issue, that's the first step that you take to control the growth. Second of all, you have to have a comprehensive plan that has meaningful language in it and a real plan for the whole county that is reflected in the zoning ordinance. And we don't have that. Our zoning ordinance has not been updated since I helped update it in 1985 when I was zoning administrator. And it hasn't been done since. Little bits and pieces have been changed over the years, but basically about 95% of it is the exact same document. It's badly out of date and it needs to be updated. As far as farming goes, I think we need to take some steps to encourage farming and to encourage some kind of small businesses in the county, like what Teresa Wood is doing, which is meat processing and doing things that where we can make a benefit out of what we do here instead of always being on the tail end of the dog. And that's what we need to do, and that requires the board to be creative and to be proactive and not just talk in generalities, but make a plan of action of what they're going to do and then implement it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Biniak.
The open spaces, the natural beauty, the dark skies, these are all God-given things to us. We didn't pay for them. They were here. But it's our job to protect them, to leave them for the future, for our children to be able to see the Milky Way, for our children to enjoy the viewscapes that we enjoy. But at the same time, there's property rights. There's individual people's desire to live their own life. And so to dictate to them exactly what they have to do here or there isn't necessarily right either. But we have to work together to come to a common goal, common good for our whole county, to protect these natural assets, these natural beauties, and to be a community around them and not fighting each other. I think we can do this. Sometimes saying the board needs to make rules or laws, that's not the way to do it. It's the building of the community, a gathering of minds for the same goal. So that's where I am. That these things need to be protected, but they don't need to be protected by laws. They need to be protected by the feeling among our people in the community that these are valuable things and we want them to be protected. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we're going to move on to the third question. And it'll start with you, Mr. Parrish, if you'd like to come on up to the podium. Our next question is an extension of the last one. We hear some residents complain that there aren't enough jobs in Rappahannock County to sustain healthy growth, that the county needs a large grocery store, a pharmacy, even big box stores. Is it possible to preserve the vistas and character and bring in additional commerce, particularly for younger people who say they can't find employment here?
We do need a pharmacy. And I think that, you know, hopefully that part of the problem with getting a pharmacy out here is that we technically have a pharmacy, which is in Dr. Martin's office. And so I don't understand all the hospital stuff, but that's been a stumbling block for getting a pharmacy to come out here. So we do need a pharmacy because we have an aging population, and that would really help. in terms of jobs. The demographics are changing in the county. We're getting a lot of people that are coming out as weekenders, and they are inadvertently creating jobs. They need housekeepers. They need people to take care of the yard. They need people to fence and take care of the property and repair and put on additions and whatever. So that doesn't solve the real problem. However, wherever you live in this county, you're 30 minutes away from a major town. And so let's say you live in Alexandria and you lived a mile and a half from your job, it would probably take you 30 minutes to get there. And so my son and all of his buddies, and I know a lot of young people, and they seem to find work. And so, yeah, I don't think we need to build a factory to create jobs. And is that, what else is there?
Yeah, that's pretty much is it possible to preserve the vistas and character and bring additional commerce at the same time?
Maybe not, maybe not. Our tax base is our houses. And I think in order to maintain the quiet lifestyle we have in this county, we have to, accept the fact that we're going to pay for it with our real estate taxes. We have the lowest real estate taxes around, other than Madison, which is only 2 cents less. And that's because they have a very low composite index, and they do have a lot of industry and a lot of sales tax. And the town of Madison, all of that money goes into the county, unlike little Washington. So in Fauquier County, their taxes are 50% higher than us. And I think as one of us mentioned, we've had the same tax rate now for 4 years. So it's possible to keep the services we have, keep our taxes down, and maintain the lifestyle that we enjoy today.
Thank you. Mr. Connick?
I'm going to ask you to repeat it.
Okay. Our next question is an extension of the last one. We hear some residents complain that there aren't enough jobs in Rappahannock County to sustain healthy growth, that the county needs a large grocery store, a pharmacy, even big box stores. Is it possible to preserve the vistas and character and bring in additional commerce, particularly for younger people who say they can't find employment here?
Well, I think the answer to the question is that, the county had a committee that studied economic development. I know Ben Jones was on it, Chris Morris was on it, quite a few others, about 10 people were on it. And they made the report, I want to say, about 10 years ago. And they made the report, they met, they discussed all these issues, and the report, nothing happened to it. The Board of Supervisors, with the two incumbents who were on the stage, did absolutely nothing about it. I've heard the same thing as I go around knocking on doors. We need a pharmacy, we need a grocery store. And the problems are, for those kind of functions, especially the grocery store or other kinds of industry or businesses, you need water and sewer. And so the only place there's water and sewer is in the town of Washington. That's outside the bailiwick of the county. That's in the town of Washington. So, and whether or not their facilities would enable that to happen is a question I don't know the answer to exactly, but I think the answer is probably no. There would have to be a substantial expansion of the facilities in order to accommodate that. Sperryville's got sewer, but it doesn't have water, so that's out. Woodville, Flint Hill don't have anything. So if this is a thing that people want to do, you have to do more than come up to the podium at election time and say, well, yeah, that's a really good idea and I support it, but after 8 years, I haven't done one single concrete step to make it happen. And so that's the answer to that question. As far as big box stores, I'm against that. In Rappahannock County, because you want to talk about lights, there's a place you're going to have a lot of lights. And I don't think the demographics of the county are such that it would support it, so it's sort of an academic question. As far as where these things can go, folks, we have a zoning ordinance and we have a comprehensive plan, and if it would be updated and if that's the consensus, that's where you put that stuff in. And some, to some extent, it now says that those kind of commercial activities are supposed to be focused around the villages. There's a commercial zone out by the co-op and the bank where that all is. So there's commercial areas. As some of you know, there was a proposal a few years back about having a Dollar General store out across from the bank. A lot of people got all upset about that. So it could be done. It's possible to do, and there's a place to do it, and there are provisions in the zoning ordinance that allow it and provide for screening and setbacks and so forth, and those have to be renewed. But if the county, the consensus of the county residents is to do a thing like that, well, then there's a way and there are mechanisms to make it happen, not just talk. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Binia.
I agree that jobs for young people are important, but I also think that big boxes, grocery stores, retail outlets, shipping outlets, they don't belong here. We don't want the traffic. We don't have the infrastructure. They're looking at 81, they're looking at 64, so they can move products. We don't have the demographics. We don't have the people to support a big grocery store. If they came in, they would close down and we'd have an empty building. I think to create jobs for our young people is in education, where they can become entrepreneurs maybe and create their own business. I've seen a number of people create their own business here in the county, whether it be internet, like Mr. Yao, he services the county, you know, he grew up here, he created a business. I created a business here because I wanted to live here. I think many of our children maybe are drawn off to the excitement of the big city, but then some come back because they enjoy the beauty of this country, this county, the community. It's just a great place to raise your children. And so it's a trade-off. I don't see the big business, a big box store thing is the solution. I think it's through education and teaching our young people how to become entrepreneurs and get out and create their own job. And it doesn't even have to be highly educated. I've seen a guy buy a used zero turn and off he goes. Next he buys a snow plow. And again, he builds a job, a business around himself that he is able to support his family. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
Could you repeat the question one more time?
Sure. We hear some residents complain that there aren't enough jobs in Rappahannock County to sustain healthy growth, that the county needs a large grocery store, a pharmacy, even big box stores. Is it possible to preserve the vistas and character and bring in additional commerce, particularly for younger people who say they can't find employment here?
Thank you for repeating that. I think that it bears remembering that we did at one time have manufacturing businesses and shipping businesses in Rappahannock County. And when you think about the Aileen plant in Flint Hill and how many, or Eileen plant in Flint Hill and how many people that employed, now when you talk to people in Rappahannock County, when you talk to natives of Rappahannock County, and you mention the Eileen plant, almost everybody says, oh yeah, my aunt worked there, or oh yeah, my dad worked there. And it was a good job for local people. It was tucked in an appropriate area for that kind of business. And it really meant a lot to people that could then afford to live where they loved and have a job that would make ends meet. We also had a place in the 80s that I worked at that was a shipping company. That was Faith Mountain Company. And of course, that was a great local success story. And there were probably 40 to 100 people employed there, depending on the season. And it was either a primary income or a secondary income for a lot of families. But it's a question of balance. It was put in an appropriately zoned area When that business shut down, it was repurposed and is now the Ginger Hill Antique Shops. So I think that there is room for some balanced growth for jobs for younger people. I actually would look forward to working with the community on that. In terms of pharmacies and grocery stores, I don't mind making the trip weekly to town, and most people that I talk to seem to think that that's a trade-off for living here, and that's a fair trade-off. But I think that there are great community resources like the senior center and aging at home that maybe could also pull resources and figure out ways to get needs met if these things can't be built out here. If they do need to be built, if the community demands are such, there are areas where they can be built without impacting the community too much. So I think that there's a lot of options on the table for our future, and the question is balance. Where's the best place? How should this look to be appropriate for our agricultural and rural nature? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Connick, would you like to start off our fourth question round?
Could you repeat?
Yeah, we'll start from scratch here. Okay. Last month, the Board of Supervisors agreed to build the county's first ad hoc proposed multi-use trail, purportedly at no cost to the county taxpayers. Do you support the trail, and do you think there was adequate public hearing on the proposal?
Well, thank you for that question. I think most everybody knows what my position is on that, and as I have gone around knocking on doors in my district, I would say I have talked to probably 400 or 500 people over the last 3 weeks, and I met exactly one person that thought the trail was a good idea for the county to do. One. So maybe in some of the other districts where the trail's going to be, it's a popular idea, but it doesn't seem to have a lot of pizzazz in my district or appeal. What my main concern about the trail is twofold. The first thing is exactly what you asked in your question. I think the process by which it was done was terrible, and it sets a terrible precedent for Rappahannock County. This thing, whether whoever's paying for it, and the notion that it's not going to cost the taxpayers any money, I think is a canard. That is just not true. The trail is going to cost, one from Washington Sperryville, according to the committee's own engineer, $5.9 million if they don't hit certain problems and if certain things are worked out. And 80% of that money is coming from some grant. Well, grant money doesn't grow on trees. There's no such thing as free money, and there's no such thing as extra money. So, not in my life, anyway. So, that's a kind of a canard. The second thing is, if this was a good idea and it was something the county really wanted to do, they should have had public hearings. First of all, it should have been in the comprehensive plan. I come back to that time and time again, and if you read the VDOT documents, you find out that's what they're expecting. Is this a proposal? Is this something that's in the county's transportation plan? In the comprehensive plan? And the answer is no, it's not in there. There's some general talk that's been quoted and cited, but that's not what they're talking about. The second thing is, even if it was in there and it went to the Planning Commission and they had a public hearing to amend the comprehensive plan and so forth, a project of this magnitude, the biggest thing we've ever done in the county, would have to go to a public hearing and have people comment. The other thing is, this package was presented as a fait accompli of the route, of the cost, and so forth, and I think that's just wrong. There was no opportunity for public input, or if there was, it was very inadequate, and it was after it was already presented. So my time's about to run out, and I want to say one more thing about the money. If the people who are proposing it have the money, and they have it committed or pledged, as I said at the public hearing, let them, at the meeting where it was approved, let them put up a performance bond backed up by an irrevocable letter of credit, or put all the money in an escrow account so the taxpayers are assured they won't get stuck with the bill. And in fact, they've been presented with a memorandum of understanding from another county which does exactly that. That's how they did it down in that other county.
Thank you. So
thank you. Thank you.
Mike, what do you have to say?
Yeah, the multi-use, multi-purpose trail, I think is a community building trail, although we're fighting about it now. But if you're a mother with a baby in a stroller and you want to take her out, the baby out for a little fresh air in the stroller, you take it down the road and the truck's coming, you're trying to get off the road with a baby in a stroller. This is a place where you can go and be safe with your child in a stroller. You got a child that has just learning to ride a bicycle. You take them down the road, here comes a truck. You're trying to get the bike, the child off the road. It's not safe. This is a place where you can take your child, learn to ride a bike, and it's safe from getting run over. If you're jogging, you're jogging down a road, you're in liable of getting hit. Our roads don't have shoulders, they're narrow. Many of them are gravel where you would jog or ride a bike. They're not safe. I think this is a good idea. It may not have been presented exactly how some people preferred things to be presented, but this is not a typical project that a landowner brings forward. This is a project that has been brought forward by an ad hoc committee, I'll call them, that have worked very hard at no cost to the county to put together something that I think will be good for the county, where you go jogging, where you ride a bike, where maybe our track team, our cross-country team, would have a chance to be able to go work out, where our elderly will be able to take a stroll down the road. When you're 79 years old and taking a stroll down the road, how fast can you get out of the way of that next truck? And I have to admit, I drive too fast too. I'm not expecting to see those things on the road. And it's a shame that our community doesn't have a place and an opportunity to enjoy the outdoors in a safe place. So I'm for it. I think it's a good idea. And I think the memorandum of understanding is probably the appropriate way, I think, in the future, if we get the grant. We don't even know if we're going to get a grant. It hasn't been awarded. It won't be awarded until the summertime. We'll have plenty of time for public comment then. Thank you.
Thank you. Christine.
Well, I'm a little bit beyond the babies and stroller stage, but I do still have kids that ride bicycles and ride skateboards. And I do know safe places in the county that take them that nobody has to pay for me to take my kid to ride his bike or ride his skateboard. In talking to people around the county, I just don't think that there's a lot of support for this plan. I think that maybe a very small percentage, judging maybe 1 or 2% from the people that I talk to, and from also keeping up with it on social media, support this plan. And I think it's a group to be commended for doing a lot of work and having a lot of enthusiasm for the project, but I just don't see broad-based support for it. And, you know, certainly if people want to know places to take their kids, call me. I can't announce them here because everybody will be there. But if you call me, I will be glad to cue you in on some, you know, I learned to drive in Rappahannock County, so I can help you with that too. So, call me. It's a neighborhood question. We can solve this as a community. Where can our kids go to ride their bikes? Where can we take a walk safely? Where can we push our child in a stroller? I can name them off for you. Call me. In terms of whether the county needs to get caught up in it, it's just not a priority. There's so much now on the dance card for the county already, working through updating the comprehensive plan, updating our zoning ordinances to announce or to address so many ongoing issues like the events, venues that seem to cause so much contention, and also the Airbnbs that seem to be kind of splitting neighborhoods apart, our aging infrastructure in the county buildings. There just seem to be so many priorities, including our fire and rescue services and how we're going to proceed with them. I just think this is something that's It's just not a priority, and while I appreciate the attention that people have put into it, it's not something that I support. Thank you.
Thank you. Chris?
So this bike path has really turned into a political football. And first of all, I really don't consider it to be a bike path. I think the initial concept that it would go from Washington to Sperryville, yeah, okay, you got a bike path. But 1.2 miles, you know, is really a walking path. And although I have had parents tell me that they would love to have a place to take their children to teach them to ride a bike on a safe place, I have, I understand that it's important to the schools in their emergency planning to have the two schools connected. And I'm not sure exactly why, but I can see that if 211 got shut down and they had to harbor the kids into one of the schools that had the generator, then they could walk them through on the bike path. But I do know it's from the school superintendent that this is part of her safety plan. I do envision, walking is healthy, exercise is good. I do envision parents that would have their kids in soccer practice, say, well, let's just take a walk while these kids are, you know, till they finish. I envision parents, especially mothers that are dropping off their kids, well, let's meet for a walk, you know, when we drop the kids off to school. I think it'd be used, and I think that the cross-country team would use it. And it would, I mean, 2 miles is a decent, you know, run, so I envision people that would run with it. I would never support this bike path if I believed that the taxpayer would have to pay for it. And we voted to pass a resolution in order for these rap trails to apply for this grant. The grant money has already been taken, you know, taxed by the federal government. It's already in a pot. It's been siphoned down to VDOT. And as everybody knows, they pay 80% of it. You know, it's like it's a $1 million project, the 1 mile, 1.2 miles. They pay 80% of it. The other money is raised, and yes, it's true, it either should be an escrow or bonded or whatever, guaranteed. And then if we get the grant, if there's any glitches, we don't have to accept the grant. But I would never accept the fact that the taxpayers would have to pay any money toward this project, period.
Thank you. Okay, we're gonna start our next round of questions. We're gonna start with you, Mike. There's been a great deal of discussion around our aging population and the volunteer EMS and fire personnel that serve county residents. Due to lack of young people in Rappahannock County, many of our first responders are senior citizens serving senior citizens. What are your thoughts on paid EMS and firefighters?
That is true. Many of our volunteer rescue people and even our volunteer firemen are all senior citizens. It's not a unique problem to our county. When you talk to other communities, rural communities, they have the same problem. We have an aging population. It's one of the opportunities for a young man to get into a paying career. It pays well. And I think we'll have it here someday. I'm not sure when. It's part of our new fire and rescue and county agreement to look forward to a 5-year plan to see where we are and when we need to bring this into process. It may come in sooner than that. We're not, haven't figured out if it should be the rescue company hiring somebody or the county hiring somebody. There's a lot of questions about that, but all indications it's coming, and it's going to cost the taxpayers some money. But it's important to have that coverage because we are an aging population. I've been lucky. I haven't had to call an ambulance for myself, for my wife, for my family. But I live on a dangerous curve, and I call the ambulance about once a year for somebody that's run off the road. And they've been very good. They've been very responsive. I have never seen them, even at 2 o'clock in the morning, take much time at all. It's impressive. But as we go forward, I know some of them are pushing 70. Or maybe even older. And it's hard to lift some people into a gurney and into an ambulance. So it's coming, and I think it's something that the county will deal with and will pay for one way or another. Thank you.
Thank you. But Christy?
Thank you, Teresa. Thank you. Sorry. Thank you, Marianne. In terms of an aging population, I mentioned earlier that I live next to my mother, Margaret Eubank. And the reason that we moved back 4 years ago was because as she's getting older, don't tell her I said that, oh, wait, this is being taped. I wanted to be there to support her, to make sure her needs were met. I know this is a challenging place to get older. In her final years, my great-grandmother came to live with us, and she actually went to the senior center, which is a great way for people to stay engaged. And it's wonderful that our community has that to keep our seniors active and engaged. In terms of seniors serving seniors, I think once we start hiring EMS personnel, it's going to be a slippery slope. I would like to see a concerted effort for volunteerism before we go into hiring people. And I don't know that, I've been to a few meetings about this, and I feel that it's not been put out there that the choices that we're basically facing are, you know, we work out the volunteer situation or our taxes are going to increase. That's it. So, I mean, I know personally of people that would probably be willing to volunteer if they were given that simple solution. And that's exactly where we're headed. So I'm hoping that with the comprehensive plan being refined, once I'm elected, we can start looking at ways to improve volunteerism for a younger population. Maybe if we can encourage employers to allow people to leave to serve their community, that would be wonderful. And then also RAPU offers classes now for EMT, different classes that will enable people to get the training that they need for these community services. So I'd like to see an increased call for volunteerism and training before we resort to hiring personnel. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Okay, Chris.
At the last meeting we had with the fire chiefs, I asked them to put their heads together and see what it would take to go ahead and start a hybrid system like a lot of counties have, where there is a combination of volunteerism and paid EMS. Everybody I've talked to wants the ambulance to go out when the call comes in. The way it is now, there's allowed 8 minutes to get to the station and then I think 14 minutes to get to the patient. And our volunteers do a terrific job. They could not get there any quicker than they do. But they also don't need paid people for much of the time. What it is they have their own work schedules. They all fill in, but there's some gaps where it would be nice to have paid state EMS. So once we get a county administrator, a permanent county administrator, there's no sense trying to start to implement the process now because our government is in a little bit of turmoil and we're changing, you know, leadership in the county office. So once we get a permanent county administrator, I think that's about the first thing I'd like to get started is seeing about having a hybrid system and having a part, you know, paid people that are sitting there to go out as soon as the call comes in. And I guess that's pretty simple that way. It may cost a little more, but I think, especially with our aging population, we need to provide that service.
Thank you. Mr. Connick.
Well, again, I hear a lot of generalities and nothing specific. First of all, I think the notion that somehow this depends on a county administrator or not a county administrator is a little inaccurate. This is a program, or this is something that's been discussed for years now by the Fire Rescue Association with the Board of Supervisors. And they had a meeting, I also attended it 2 weeks ago, and the two supervisors who are up here running for re-election, one of them said, this is their own version 9 of the agreement between the county and the association and all the fire companies. One of them said, this is all technical and legal and I really don't understand it at version 9. The other one said, I'm ignorant about this, I have to admit it, and I really don't understand it. And I think this is the most important question you've asked tonight, because it's, believe it or not, there's something that's even more important than zoning. In my mind, and that is emergency and rescue in the county. If we go to a paid system, which is what is being talked about, they're talking about putting on two, if they haven't read the agreement, they're talking about putting on two full-time positions, each one is going to cost $600,000, give or take, because you have to have people on shifts, you have to have a weekend shift, and you have to have them manned 24/7. You have to have people, you have to have facilities built at some fire hall, wherever they're going to be, these two people, and they have to have bunks, they have to have facilities that we don't have, which are going to cost in the neighborhood, I've been told, of several million dollars to upgrade our physical plant so we can do it. You know, so this is going to cost, just those two things are going to put an increase in taxes of 15% to 20% to 25%, depending on how much they do. And that's going to be a huge burden. We have absolutely no reserves now, thanks to the imprudent lack of financial planning that this Board of Supervisors has failed to do. We have not a penny. They didn't raise the tax rate last year, and then after they passed the budget, they used up all the money in that tax rate, pass-throughs or no pass-throughs, they added $590,000 to the budget, 3 months into the year. Now, I want to go back to something about volunteerism, that if you want to encourage volunteers, you have to do something for them. Now, the Board of Supervisors took care of itself, and the Board of Supervisors took care of the school board. They have full health benefits paid for by you. But the firemen and the rescue people, I don't know if you know the story about this Jenkins boy over here in Washington, got hurt on the way to a rescue call. There was a cap in his insurance policy that was used up the first day. So rather than spend the money imprudently on themselves, if they want to promote volunteerism and try and save our fire and rescue, they ought to spend the money where it's needed on the people who risk their lives for us all the time. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to question number 6. So, it's been a difficult year and a half for the Rappahannock County government. A longtime county administrator retired, his replacement resigned within a year's time, The deputy administrator just recently resigned after fewer than 4 months on the job. That said, both the administrator and deputy administrator posts remain unfilled. Meanwhile, questions surrounding procurement practices and workforce management has led to a Virginia State Police investigation of the county government. What, in your opinion, is the cause of this upheaval, and what will you do as a supervisor to restore the normal function of government?
Thank you. I did want to mention, I forgot to mention, in encouraging volunteerism, I think we can better allocate our resources to providing incentives for our volunteers as well. That would be a way to build their ranks up as, in addition to just encouraging volunteerism. Our county government really has been through in the ringer in the last year and a half, 15 months. When someone leaves after 30 years on the job, there are often a lot of questions to be answered. As I think it was in the Rappahannock News article, it's like a big oak falls in the forest. And what are you going to do to fill that space? And I think we still have this huge void in the county government where John McCarthy used to be. I think there's a lack of leadership. I think it was very unfortunate that Ms. Kaiser's term as our administrator was so brief, since she had the advantage of studying with John for the position before he retired. We were really counting on that to help us in the future. And we were very fortunate that Brenda Garten is now doing so well in seeing us through to our full-time administrator that we're going to hire in January. What can I do to help with this? I come from a background of management, administration, working on boards where I have faced these kind of challenges before. I worked at WorldCom when we were going through bankruptcy, and I had probably 10 emails a day that opened up with, "No wonder you're in bankruptcy." Yeah, there's problems with my bill again this month. And my job was to turn that around, right the ship, and change people's opinion of that company. And when I took over in that department, we had never had positive reviews ever from any client. By the time I left, with the different policies I implemented, the way we handled workflow, we reduced our turnaround time, and we regularly got rave reviews from our clients. That's how I want to treat the people of Rappahannock County. I believe they need to be treated like our clients, like our customers, like people whose opinion is foremost when I go about doing my job. I will do my very best to try to right the ship in Rappahannock. I'm level-headed, I have a steady hand, I've been through many crisis situations before. I took over as a parish administrator in Georgia for a gentleman who had been there 20 years. He was in his 70s, and on my second day on the job, I said, "Where do you back everything up?" And he said, "Where? What do you mean back up?" And I blanched from head to toe. So I know what it means to need to get the ship righted and to take on a challenge. And I'm very much looking forward to the opportunity.
Thank you, Christine.
Thank you.
Appreciate that.
That's a 30-minute question, not a 3-minute question.
Let's see how
so
concise you can get.
It's the crux of the matter is the main reason that I decided to run for supervisor again. We're going through a 30-year shakeup, and I think historically that happens with empires and regimes and county and not just county governments, but big governments. So I think once we get it straightened out, we'll have a smooth time for a long time. We just need to get the right people in the right places. And so I pledge to do my best, if reelected, to get the ship back on an even keel. Thank you.
Thank you. David.
You only used up 1 minute of 30.
You know, I'm going to quote my favorite Yogi Berra quote, which is, if you don't know where you're going, you're liable to end up somewhere else. This whole problem, I want to say that I knew John McCarthy. He came here shortly after I left the post of zoning administrator and took over that job, and also the four or five other hats I wore at the time. He took over as a county administrator from Diane Bruce, who basically did it in her capacity as clerk. And over the years, he earned a great deal of respect. He was very competent. He was mentored by great people like Pete Estes and Newell Miller, who taught him zoning and taught him what he needed to know, and also Dick McNear, even though Dick wasn't officially part of the county government, but was zoning administrator in Fauquier. And John was smart, and he learned it, and he did it basically, for the most part, a very good job. But the other side of that double-edged sword was the county board of supervisors, and all the board of supervisors that are on there now, I think, with the possible exception, Mr. Frazier, all came on board after John was already there. So by that time, John was sort of, I guess you'd say, running things, and knew more about just about every topic than the board members. And unfortunately, they deferred and deferred and deferred, and I think they created this problem because they don't know where they're going. They don't know these jobs. They don't know what is involved. And as a result of that, John left, which, I mean, nobody stays forever. So they had no contingency plan of what to do. And now they're basically, as you see, flailing about, golly gee, what are we going to do now? Let's hire this one. Let's hire that one. These gentlemen, I know them all. I have a great deal of respect for them. It's not personal. But the fact of the matter is they don't have any management experience of this nature to know what they're trying to do, what they need in a county administrator other than, oh my goodness, somebody just like John. Well, you're not going to get somebody just like John right off the shelf because John was the product of years of experience here. I have the kind of experience not only in this country running a Washington office of a New York law firm, I also manage big projects overseas, multi-million dollar projects, and had 30, 40 people that reported to me in five or six different offices. You got to figure out what is the job. You got to find the people that are competent and qualified and then put them in place, and then you have to have strict not only a way of accountability to see if they're doing the job and getting it done. And if they're not, guess what? You have to fire somebody sometimes and show that you know how to manage. And if you don't know how to manage, this problem's never going to get solved. And the fact that it hasn't been solved in 2 years is emblematic of we need new leadership and people in the position with some kind of experience that can lead and get the job done.
Thank you, sir.
It's true, we've had almost 100% turnover in our government. And it even started back when, when Schwartz left or Gary Settles left, Connie came in, Diane Bruce left, John McCarthy left, Francis Foster left, Beverly left, everybody left. And we had a big hole to fill, and we're trying our best to fill that hole. We've hired one person. She didn't quite have the experience. We thought she would be able to grow into it if we gave her the opportunity. Well, this county did not give her the opportunity. And unfortunately, she's gone. It's costing the county more money because now we're looking for much higher caliber experience opportunity. That costs more money. Other people in the county that have left have left under duress because we're working kind of like a Model T car. We weren't up to the fastest, highest speed. We had a very casual procurement process. Nobody was cheating anybody. Nobody was taking county money. But it wasn't like Fairfax. It wasn't up to that speed. And now it's going to be. You know, when I was in Fairfax, you go to the building office to get a permit. It was a half a day ordeal. I come here, it's not. It's because we were a community that was small, we trusted each other, and we did a good job. as we go forward, we're going into a much higher caliber. Francis was pretty much pen and paper accounting. Now we have Debbie Nick in there. We have a very good accounting system, but it caused a lot of problems because we weren't used to it. It also opened up our eyes to where our money was going. And I don't believe it was going to any place that it wasn't supposed to be. But now it's, you know, he mentioned the $600,000 or $500,000 money that 3 months into the budget year. Well, most of that money, because of our new process, needs a line item to go to. We can't spend the money before we put it into the system and before it has a line item. Much of that money was pass-through money, a PATH grant to the school for their physical health program, some grants to Connie and the Sheriff's Department. Only a small portion of that money was going for new jobs, I think $75,000 for a new assistant to Brenda, because we're operating at a higher technical level. Doing our county board meeting minutes is now enough. It wasn't getting done. We didn't have the personnel. We're now working towards getting that personnel. So, thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate that. All right, Mr. Parrish, would you like to take the next question? So, the state of Virginia, as well as most states across the nation, recognize and support tourism as a viable revenue stream. With local tax increases on the horizon, do you think there should be a greater focus on tourism as a viable revenue stream in Rappahannock County? And should more taxpayer dollars be spent promoting Rappahannock County?
Tourism, I knew that question was coming. Tourism does help the revenue stream. I have a problem with having a big budget toward promoting tourism, because you're promoting the recipients of the tourism, and you're taxing the people that don't benefit from tourism to create that budget. What I'm talking about, and once you get over to the fact that it's a lot of income, coming in, then that's one thing. But I believe that tourism, I've seen it increase. I've seen our food and lodging tax double, basically in the last 8 years, and so it's gone from 100,000 to 200,000, and so it's growing. We have a tourism office, and I think it's a slow process, and I know there's a lot of spillover with tourism. So yeah, I support tourism. I believe in tourism. I think we have to be careful too. I don't anticipate necessarily that tourism will ruin the county. I mean, back in the 70s, I used to ship cattle down to Costa Rica, and that was a fabulous place, and you go back there now, the place is ruined, tourism ruined it. I don't think we got to worry about that here, but still, you got to be a little careful about overdoing it. So, to answer your question, I really don't know what the best answer is. I think it's like a combination of encouraging tourism, but not necessarily throwing a lot of money into a budget to enhance the process.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Could you repeat it again?
Yep.
I think there was the second part I missed.
Can we read the whole thing?
Yeah. Please, if you would.
State of Virginia, as well as most states across the nation, recognize and support tourism as a viable revenue stream. With local tax increases on the horizon, Do you think there should be a greater focus on tourism as a viable revenue stream in Rappahannock County? And should more taxpayer dollars be spent on promoting Rappahannock County?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, I think the answer to that is in a couple of parts. First of all, when you say, the predicate of your question is looming tax increases, but the incumbents say we're not going to have any tax increases. So I'm not sure where that came from, but I agree there are looming tax increases because of the fire and rescue situation is the number one reason. And I want to correct something that Mr. Parrish said. He was quoted in the newspaper saying, I think we are in good shape. We have one of the lowest tax rates compared to neighboring counties, and I think those rates will stay the same indefinitely. That's from an interview in the Rappahannock News that was published last week. Well, Rappahannock has a tax base based on the composite index they use for the Department of Education of $1.9 billion of real estate that's taxed. And the average tax bill in Rappahannock County is $2,287, according to the Virginia Department of Taxation. And we have a tax rate of 70 cents. In Madison County, contrary to what was said before, they have a tax base, their composite index is higher than ours, $2.1 billion. But they have an average tax bill of $1,169, less than half of what our average tax bill, and their tax rate is 68 cents this year. Culpeper's got a tax composite index of $5.5 billion and an average tax bill of $1,788, about $300 or $400. It's always bad for me to try to do math in public, less than ours. So I don't think it's accurate to say that we're doing great compared and we have low taxes compared to other counties. And as I've gone around, a lot of old people and a lot of young working people with families and children who go to the schools have told me if it keeps on like this, they're going to have to sell and move. And I think that's tragic. As far as the revenue stream from tourism, as Chris just said, it's about $200,000. And if you add on some implied, I don't know how you figure it out, because we get a kickback from, or give us money back from sales tax. But how you calculate how much of the sales tax is from tourists, it's really impossible to do. But even if you say a quarter of it is, you basically have about $250,000, $300,000. It's a drop in the bucket. If they put one paid fire position on, that's $600,000. Tourism doesn't generate revenue here like in other places, anywhere near enough to justify cross-subsidizing it out of taxpayer dollars. And I think that whatever we're doing now is exactly enough, and I would not propose to increase it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Soft tourism, B&B, restaurants, as opposed to what I call rough tourism, large events, is something I think that won't impact the quality of life here in the county, and it does add to the economic base. I promote tourism, but soft tourism. Those people that come out and enjoy our natural beauty, those that come out enjoy the community we have, whether it's come to the theater to see our community theater or eat at some of our fine restaurants. We have a lot of people that come out here just to eat at the inn. All that money, tourist money, goes to the town. It supports the town royally. I think tourism is better in the big box stores. I agree that I paid more than $2,000 in taxes to the county. But I think that taking advantage of that meals and lodging tax, taking advantage of the things that we have here, our artisan trail coming or the artisan tour coming up, is a wonderful way to create a little bit of income. It's not a whole lot, but a little bit of income. It takes a little bit of an edge off our property tax. The more we build a community where we can work and live, we'll support our beautiful place here. But if we have to drive to work someplace else, you're not supporting our own community, our own economic base. And that economic base supports our taxes. So I think finding the jobs, and part of that jobs is probably tourism. Half or part of the people that we hire is because of the B&B, which is tourism. And those people that come to that B&B, they quite often go out to antique stores or wineries or eat dinner. It's not just coming our little B&B, but there's three or four other things that are also earning money here in the county, and that money stays in that county. So, and I think to promote tourism, you need to mow the grass and make it grow. So putting a little money towards tourism will help it grow, and I think it's important to be soft tourism, where it's gentle, it's coming out to enjoy the natural beauty of this place. Thank you.
Thank you. Christine?
I think I'm going to go back to a theme that I hit on earlier, which is that for me, tourism and livability in Rappahannock County is a question of balance. I love this county. I think it's gorgeous that people want to come out here and spend their time and spend their money. It's a no-brainer. But how much are we getting? We're getting about $250,000 in tourism revenue. So what should we be expected as a county to invest to get that return? I think what we're doing now is about right. We have several great programs. The Farm Tour is a great tourism program that the county helps out with. The Artisan Trail is coming up. Living down in Sperryville, I wish that someone would revive the Apple Festival that we used to enjoy when I was a teenager. And I wish someone would revive it and make it a fundraiser for schools or fire and rescue. I watch people pass through this county during apple season in the fall, and they go right over to Madison County to Graves Mountain Lodge, and they just hand over as much money as they can. I would like to figure out ways to keep that revenue in Rappahannock County. I think that we need to work on our reputation for being open to the right kind of tourism businesses. I hated to see Ben Jones's establishment close, and I think about all of the money that's bought into the local economy over in Page County. I don't know that was exactly the right place for him in Rappahannock County, but that he wanted to do business in Rappahannock County and invest in where he lived is so admirable that, I wish that we could have more businesses that would be able to contribute to the economy but still be a great fit for the county. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Christine. Now, Teresa, how are we doing on time? You guys have been amazing, and you guys have been amazing, and so we have time for one audience question. And David, you're gonna. All right, ready?
I guess.
What is the most important responsibility in your representation of us as citizens in your district?
Oh, that was easy. Well, the most important job, I think, is to make sure that tax dollars are spent wisely and not squandered. And I think the most important thing that I would try to do as a supervisor is to help guide the board into a more orderly way of A, identifying things that it wants to do, and then getting them done, and prioritizing not only our spending, but prioritizing the jobs. For example, tonight, we've heard a lot of different issues that came up. The comprehensive plan is 13 years out of date. And to date, they have not done any studies which are required by state law to be done before it's updated. So we need to allocate, we need to figure out what resources we have. Can our planning commission do it? Do the members on there, can they do it? Or do we need to get a consultant or get somebody to do the analysis that's needed to be done? And then see that it gets done. We need to update our zoning ordinances, and so that's a priority. And you know, the Board of Supervisors, as most people who follow it have noticed, suddenly they're not having just one meeting a month, they're having two meetings and three meetings and special meetings, and they have a limited amount of time. And so it has to be prioritized, and yet I see something, and I don't want to beat a dead horse, but the bike trail is not a priority item for this county, according to my constituents. It might be a nice idea, maybe, maybe not, I don't know, but it managed to come in, and basically I feel like the board was stampeded because they don't have a work plan. They don't manage their time or budget their time appropriately and say, well, that's very nice. We have all these other things that we've got to address, EMS, got to get that agreement done, got to get the zoning done, we got to get the comprehensive plan done, and then we'll take up your bike trail or your walking trail, whatever, when we have the time and the resources, financial as well as human resources. You know, it put a great deal of strain on our county administrator, meetings with people and evaluating this and talking to the highway department when they could have been doing other things that are much more important. And that's where I think money is wasted, because that's time we pay for in our county administration. And so we need to prioritize that, and the board really badly needs that. It can't be reactive like it's been for years and years and years. We need to be proactive, and we need to identify problems like broadband. To me, that's a cell tower business, all that, and the phone lines, way more important than a bike trail. And the EMS, those people, our lives depend on it. Maybe not every day, but when we need them, they gotta be there. That's a huge priority, not a bike trail, because guess what? If you have to go to the hospital or you need your house is on fire, they're not coming on a bicycle.
Thank you.
The most important thing that the Board of Supervisors does is to help create the quality of life that we have here in the county, to help protect the people and their individual rights, to provide the EMS service, the fire service, to provide the building office and the inspection service, to provide the money for the health department. All these are things that the county government does to make the quality of life here in the county. Our other big job, our biggest job, is to balance those needs with the cost. And we've been very diligent to keep that cost, that tax dollar, to a minimum. And maybe that's one of our biggest faults, has been too tight with the money and not spending it and moving into the 23rd century faster. We've been working very much like a slow, comfortable country county that hasn't chase the newest and fanciest technology to keep up with more city, counties, towns. So keeping that tax dollar low and providing those services that are important for our quality of life and our health. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I really believe that the keys to, or the reason that I would want to be involved with the Board of Supervisors is in particular to address getting a new comprehensive plan and getting our planning ordinances in order, our zoning ordinances in order. I come to these meetings for the Board of Supervisors and something comes up that's not addressed in the comprehensive plan, that's not addressed in the zoning ordinances, and it tears communities apart. People are very acrimonious in the way that they, it just becomes so much more because we don't have any clear guidance on so many things that are going on in our community. It's a matter of sitting down getting input, doing the work, getting our guiding documents back in order, getting clear leadership in our administrative offices to implement those plans, and moving forward toward the future. Moving forward toward the future is the most important thing we're going to do. Address the things as they exist now and move toward the future. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Chris?
Well, as I've said before, the job of a supervisor is a balancing act between protecting the taxpayer and providing services. And so you just have to figure out, you know, where that fulcrum is. Another thing that's important is maintaining communication with not just the people and the constituents in one's own district, but really in the whole county. I don't really, when I vote, it's not, you know, for my district, it's for the whole county. And I will say that I have returned every single phone call I've gotten right away. I'm not much with the computer, and there's like one or two emails that I have not returned. Name of yours, Melanie. And it's also, you gotta make some tough decisions, you know, uncomfortable decisions. You know, recently we had a case where a person was applying for events, and you know, there was no, in my opinion, no reason to turn them down. I mean, I voted in favor of the application. But meanwhile, all the opponents, and they were considerable, were all my friends. You know, they were the people I socialized with. You know, they're the ones I've known for many, many years. You know, the applicant, I didn't even know, you know, but yet I voted in her favor and not all my friends, because I thought that was the right decision. So it's just, you know, part of the job. So I hope that answered the question.
Thank you very much. Thank you to all of you. Now we have, for the closing statements, we've randomly selected them, the order before we started. So we're gonna start 3 minutes each. And the first one up is Mr. Parrish.
Okay, I feel like I was just here. So, I mean, I don't know if this is the right time to like correct some facts that, you know, are not correct. I know that Mr. Bennett touched on some of them, and in terms of the supplemental budget that we have. No, we have not. I think it was stated we had $590,000 added to the budget. No. There is basically $66,230 added to the budget that is a permanent addition. There's another $38,000 that's like one time this year only, not next year, not again. And one of those is our litigation fund, because we're dealing with numerous frivolous lawsuits. And the others, you know, the others are, it really totals $411,734.95. And all the others are offsetting grants, reimbursements, and funds that were, you know, left over from a prior year that has to, you know, get back into the budget, but it's not a burden to the taxpayer. That tax has already been paid. So I just want to say that I would wish we could stick to the facts on these things. We've already talked about the bike path, and consider myself a bridge between the old regime and the new regime. You know, I've been here all my life. I've been going to supervisors meetings, you know, for many years. I think I might mention mention, I was there when we did the first zoning ordinance and a whole lot of other. I've been involved all this time, and you know, we have some changes to make, and I'm here to help implement those changes. So I think that's about all I have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We appreciate that. Next up, Mr. Biniak.
Thank you.
You've probably already noticed I'm probably the shortest one with any of the answers to the questions. I'm not a big talker. I like to go to the meat of a fact or meat of an issue, get it done, get it over with. I think I could do a good job. I'm here for the people of the county, and I hope to create a future with you, people of the county, one that we can be happy with, that our children can be happy with. And so I hope to see you all at the November 7th at the polls. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Next up, it's Mr. Connick.
Ladies and gentlemen and fellow candidates, I want to again say thank you for being here and thank you to everybody who helped put this on. With the possible exception of the members of the board here on the stage and a couple of them are in the audience tonight, I've probably been to more Board of Supervisors meetings, Planning Commission meetings, and Board of Zoning Appeals meetings than anyone else in the room since coming to Rappahannock over 40 years ago. I served as Rappahannock County Zoning Administrator, Subdivision Agent, Soil and Erosion Control Officer, Building Official, Clerk to the Board of Zoning Appeals, Consultant to the Planning Commission, and I'm currently a member of the Board of Zoning Appeals since 2014. In addition, I'm a past president of the Lions Club, and I'm a past director of Wakefield Country Day School for 6 years. So I know about education and budgets, believe me. I've seen many changes since I first came to the county in about 1970, some good and some not so good. This theater was a storage warehouse when I came here, and I was one of the people that helped renovate it, so it's nice to be back on the stage. The last time I was up here, I was performing Who's On First with Steve Hostetter. Now the county's facing some very serious development pressures, some very serious financial issues that we've talked about, and some very serious management challenge that we've also talked about tonight. I feel that my education and my practical experience, not only in the various positions that I've had in the county, but in my law firm and international management experience, all make me uniquely qualified to help the board and moreover help the county navigate the very difficult waters that are ahead of us. It was not my idea to run in this race. It's very hard work. It's hard work to run for election. It's hard work to get ready for a thing like this tonight. It's hard to put yourself out there and to drive around knocking on doors of friends and also complete strangers and ask for their votes. It's demanding not only physically but mentally as well. If elected, this will only be the beginning because it's going to require even more hard work and dedication to the job of supervisor the way it deserves, indeed the way it demands to be done, with thoroughness, thoughtfulness, and dedication. But I have the experience and the conviction and the energy to work for the people of my district and for the county to do what needs to be done. Sometimes I have to chuckle when I hear somebody who recently moved to Rappahannock County say how they love Rappahannock. Well, I've walked her, I've canoed her, thanks to Chris who taught me how to canoe, driven around her, raised my two boys here. I've seen her with her leaves on and her leaves off for most of my adult life. So when I say I love her, I think I know what it means. I am proud to call Rappahannock County my home, and I am doing this because this is my way to say thank you to all the friends I have here, yes, even Chris Parrish, and to give back a little something for all that Rappahannock County has given me.
Thank you,
sir. And I ask for your vote on November 7th. Thank you.
Ms. Smith.
I just want to thank everyone again this evening for putting on this event so we could get together to discuss the challenges that are facing our county. Thinking about what we expect in our supervisors and in talking to voters for the last few months, there were some criteria that I came up with, and the more I talk to people, the more I'm convinced that they're sound. So this is my pledge to you. I will be competent. I will be well prepared for meetings. I will follow through with my commitments. I will actively participate in committees that I take on. I will adhere to the Freedom of Information Act. I will avoid conflicts of interest. I will subscribe to records retention. And I will follow correct parliament procedure for meetings and encourage my peers to do the same. I will work with the county to institute job descriptions and performance reviews and transition plans for the county positions. I will be accountable. I will make my own decisions based on input from the voters of Piedmont District, not special interest groups. You will never catch me saying, my lawyer told me to say this. And I will stand by them and not expect the county to bail me out if my decisions are questioned. And being accountable, I will safeguard your hard-earned tax dollars. I will be responsive. I'm in the book, I'm in Sperryville, I'm online. Please shoot me an email if you have a concern, or even better, let's sit down and have a cup of coffee. And I'd really love to have sit-downs before every Board of Supervisors meeting to hear what the people of Piedmont District think. In that vein, I also believe in being empowering, and that's why I'm running for Board of Supervisors. I feel so many people in Rappahannock County think their voices are lost in the shuffle. I will ensure participation is encouraged at meetings and look forward to hosting supervisor forums like we had in recent history but have been abandoned this summer. I support doing public business at public meetings and not after hours like the last Board of Supervisors meeting that went on till almost 1 o'clock in the morning. I look forward to November 7th. I'll be at the polls all day. Please come and talk to me if you're wondering if you should vote for me. I would love to have an opportunity to win your vote. I'm qualified to be a steady, informed voice for Piedmont District, and I bring my unique perspective as a young family, a member of the upcoming generation, as a woman, and I ask for your vote on November 7th. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I learned a great deal today, and I appreciate your sharing your points of view. And you guys rock. You are very respectful and very quiet, and now, I think, is a good time to give them some applause. So much for coming out. I want to thank the audience for being supportive and respectful of the candidates. I want to take the time to thank the candidates for being respectful of each other and the audience time this evening. And last but not least, I want to thank Marianne Clyde, who I think did a fabulous job as tonight's moderator.
We also thank Teresa Wood, who did an amazing job putting this together.
I think in closing, I can say one thing for certain. We are all here because we love Rappahannock County. We care about this place, and we want to see it taken care of. And I think tonight, you've had a little insight into the people and the candidates who are interested in your vote. Please go to the polls on November the 7th and cast your vote there. There are a lot of issues and questions that we were not able to address tonight, and I apologize for that,
But in the interest of time, we had to call it at 9:15, or almost 9:15. Having said that, there's more conversation to be had. Tula's has been kind enough to stay open tonight, so I invite you all to walk across the street and continue this conversation. Thank you very much for coming. Good night.